Hi, everyone. Thanks so much for coming, especially with so many excellent talks at the same time. I'm Arias Pomonis, and I'm going to be presenting KRXRX, a system that protects the kernel against just-in-time code reuse attacks. This is a joint work with my colleagues at Columbia, Theophilos Petsios, and my advisor, Angelos Keromitis, Michalis Polychronakis from Stony Brook University, and Vasilios Kemarlis from Brown University. So before I start describing the system, let me talk very briefly about myself. I'm a PhD candidate at Columbia University. Specifically, I'm a member of the Network Security Lab. And throughout my time at Columbia, I've focused mainly on system security. Specifically, I spent some time working on data flow tracking, both statically through the use of compiler process and dynamically through code instrumentation and dynamic binary instrumentation. However, over the past few years, I've turned my attention to kernel security, which is also the topic of this presentation. And I'm mainly interested in the defense part, so I'd like to come up with ideas on how to prevent attackers from exploiting kernel vulnerabilities to elevate their privileges. Admittedly, I'm not the only one interested in kernel vulnerabilities. This is a graph that shows the number of reported vulnerabilities for all kernels, Mac, Windows, Linux, and so on. And as you can see, from 2001 to 2017, we have a clear upwards trend. People are more and more interested in identifying and reporting kernel vulnerabilities. In addition, the image remains the same if we focus to the Linux kernel, which is by far the most popular open source kernel available today. Again, as you can see, we started in 2001 with less than 25 reported vulnerabilities, and this number has become more than six times larger over the past 15, 16 years. What does this mean? It means that people are interested in identifying vulnerabilities and preventing exploitation, their exploitation. And I believe the main reason for this is that it's easier, it makes more sense for the attackers to target the one piece of software that's omnipresent throughout the system execution than go after the one or two privileged user space applications that might run on the system and try to find vulnerabilities in those. So targeting the Linux kernel gives the attackers a higher attack surface. However, how do kernel vulnerabilities look like and how are they exploited? So in general, user space applications and kernel software both suffer from the same type of vulnerabilities. Memory corruption vulnerabilities such as buffer overflows, memory disclosure vulnerabilities, use after freeze, race conditions, and so on. Traditionally, in user space, attackers exploited such vulnerabilities using techniques such as code injection, in which case the attacker introduces new code to the address space and then redirects the execution flow to that piece of code that he injected, and code reuse, a technique that doesn't introduce any new code but instead reuses already existing code in a slightly different manner so that an attacker can perform arbitrary computations. These techniques have been known for years, especially code injection was the de facto exploitation technique in user space for decades, so people have come up with many ideas on how to prevent them. The two most important ones, the two most highly deployed ones are WriteXRX, a policy that marks code as non-writable and data as non-executable, thus rendering code injection ineffective, and ASLR. ASLR stands for Address Space Layout Randomization. And it's a probabilistic defense that's definitely not bulletproof, but provides some protection against code reuse attacks by randomizing the base that an application is loaded so that exploits that use fixed addresses do not work. While those were happening in the user space, in the kernel, things were very, very different. And that's because for many years, for decades, the de facto exploitation technique was read-to-user. In read-to-user attacks, attackers take advantage of the shared memory layout, essentially of the fact that the kernel can execute code that resides in the user space portion, and they do the following. So they control the user space application, and they put their shellcode there, and then they take advantage of a kernel vulnerability to either redirect a code pointer directly to that shellcode, thus executing it with kernel privileges, or if such a vulnerability is not available, to corrupt it critical data structure pointer, so for instance, a data structure in the heap or dispatch table, and then they replace it with the address of a fake copy that resides in the user space where they that they control. This data structure typically contains within it a code pointer that, in turn, when dereferenced, will execute the shell code that the attacker wishes with elevated privileges. This technique, as I said, has been known for years. So fortunately, the past few years, a number of defenses were proposed. The most important ones were probably SMEP and SMAP, hardware solutions from Intel, PXN from ARM, and we also had KernExec and UDREF from the PAX team that were software-only solutions, and KGuard that was presented at Usenet Security 2014. So now that these techniques are there, they provide strong segregation between the kernel and the user space part of the address space, thus rendering created user attacks ineffective. So that forces attackers to turn back to the roots, so they'll have to do code injection and code reuse attacks in the kernel setting. And fortunately, along with those, the defenses become relevant again. So WriteXRX still protects us against code injection in the kernel. However, KSLR, the kernel counterpart of ASLR, is much, much weaker. And that's because KSLR, for instance, on the Linux kernel for x86, has only 8 or 9 bits of entropy, depending on whether you're looking at a 32 or 64-bit system. And this only randomizes the base that the kernel is loaded at boot time. So this is a very, very low, small number of entropy bits. And admittedly, there have been a number of papers over the past few years that show that KSLR is actually bypassable. This is, of course, a consequence of the inherent flaw that both of the inherent weakness that both ASLR and KSLR suffer from, and that is that even if an attacker manages to leak a single code pointer, he can render the whole protection void. Why? Well, because the attacker can then take this leaked code pointer, compare it to the expected address, and then compute the offset. And once he has done that, he knows what's the base that the kernel has been loaded, and therefore he can update all the addresses in his exploit. So what I want you to remember from this slide is that code reuse attacks are a problem both in the user space and in the kernel, and specifically in the kernel, things are even worse because KSLR is weaker. But how are code reuse look like? How do they look like? How do they work? So in code reuse attacks, we assume that the attacker controls any number of code pointers. In this example on the right, I'm going to show you with only one. You can imagine how it looks like with multiple ones. And what the MO is the following. The attacker obtains a copy of the binary of the executable, let's say the Linux, the kernel in this, for this presentation, and then disassembles it and scans it for gadget. Gadgets are code snippets, essentially a sequence of instructions that perform some functionality, and they end with an indirect branch. Indirect branches can be return instructions, indirect jumps, indirect calls, and so on. Using those indirect branches, an attacker is able to stitch those gadgets together so that the first gadget passes the execution to the second one to the third one, and so on, thus allowing the kernel to thus allowing the attacker to perform any arbitrary computation he wishes. Notice, however, that in order for this attack to work, the attacker needs to know the exact location of its gadget. Because even if he makes a mistake of one byte, the CPU is going to execute something different, and therefore, in the case of the kernel, will probably crash the system. So a natural defense, a really simple idea to prevent code reuse attacks, is to do code diversification. What this means is that we modify the code layout so that the gadgets are no longer their original location, and therefore any code pointers that the attacker control do not point to where they should. To overcome this difficulty, attackers came up with just-in-time code reuse attacks. I'm pretty sure you're familiar in this room with this, but in any case, just-in-time in this context doesn't have anything to do with JIT compilers and JIT compilation. It merely means that the attacker controls, constructs the exploit on the fly. So how does this work? Well, the attacker takes advantage of a memory disclosure vulnerability, essentially an arbitrary memory read, and uses that to read the code section that's loaded on the memory. This way, any randomization is not applicable because the attacker now reads the randomized version of the code. Then after he has done that, it turns back to the offline code reuse attack. So essentially, the attacker will take the read code section, disassemble it, scan it for gadgets, point the code pointers to where they should, stitch them, and exploit the system. Now, even if we assume that somehow this step, the first step, reading the code, is not possible, we're still not safe. And that's because of indirect just-in-time code reuse attacks. So in this case, what the attacker does is that he doesn't read the code, but instead he harvests code pointers from the data, such as return addresses from the stack and function pointers from the heap. Using those, an attacker is able to infer the randomized code layout. So essentially, if you think about it, when you leak a return address, what happens is that you know that before that there is a call instruction, and maybe you know the instructions within the same basic block of this call, and probably you know the basic block that the return address belongs to. So this way, an attacker is able to infer the randomized code layout and therefore identify the location of the gadgets, and as a result, construct his exploit this way. So in KRXRX, we wanted to provide a comprehensive kernel protection against any type of code reuse attacks, both offline and just in time, both indirect and direct. We also wanted to do it in such a way that doesn't have a privileged entity, such as a hypervisor, and that's because the kernel is already the trusted computing base of the system, and adding a super privileged entity such as a hypervisor would only increase the attack surface for the attackers. The last thing we wanted to make sure is that we have as low an overhead as possible. To this end, we came up with a design that has two main pillars, two main components. The first one is the readXRX component. This component is responsible for marking a subset of the address space as execute-only, thus preventing attackers from reading or writing to those pages, but allowing the CPU to execute code from it. To do so, we had to separate the code and the data regions by modifying the kernel memory layout, and then we instrumented using GCC plugins any memory read with SFI-inspired range checks. It's those range checks that are responsible for preventing any attempt to read from the code, but allowing legitimate attempts to read from the data. Notice, however, that this component alone doesn't provide any protection. So essentially, it only makes a part of the address space as execute-only, but the attacker can use offline code reuse or indirect just-in-time code reuse to exploit the system. So we need to couple it with the second one, which is the fine-grained KSLR component. And this part is responsible for randomizing the code layout so that the gadgets are no longer located at their original location. And also it does so with such a high entropy that guessing attacks are very, very difficult to succeed. This way we can prevent offline code reuse attacks, and with coupling it with the readXRX component, we can prevent direct just-in-time code reuse attacks. To prevent indirect JIT code reuse attacks, we also propose two different systems to protect the return addresses. The first one is based on encryption. The second one is based on deception. So I'm going to talk obviously about all of them in detail. So let me start with the readXRX component, and then I'm going to move on to the fine-grained KSLR one. So this is the vanilla kernel memory layout. And clearly what you can see is that we have a number of code sections. We have multiple code sections that interleave with data. This is a problem for us, and that's because if we were to instrument every memory read with range checks that identify code sections, we would need multiple ones, specifically one for every code region. And of course, this would mean that the overhead would skyrocket. So to prevent this and overcome this difficulty, we modified the kernel memory layout to this one. So we patched the kernel and we created two disjoint regions. The first one is the data region, it's on the bottom. It contains all the kernel data plus all the free memory necessary to hold data regions. And also the code region on the top, which contains all the code regions that the kernel has, both from the kernel image and the loadable modules. To do so, we modified the kernel so that the linker script places the kernel, the image code on the top. And we also modified the module loader so that when the module is loaded, it splits, the data go to the data region, the code goes to the code region. By doing the above, we now facilitate having a single range check for every memory read. Essentially, for every read, we check, does it fall over the end of data? If yes, it's an attempt to read the code, so we prevent it. If not, it's a legitimate data read. Some details here. Since we moved the modules, we had to be careful about code aliases in the directly mapped memory. So we unmap any code synonyms from the FISMAP. But other than this, we didn't have to modify anything else. So all the everything else, all the memory allocation of the kernel and everything, and all the memory allocators such as kmalloc, vmalloc, slab allocators, and so on, they work as is with no additional overhead. So now that I've shown you and you have an idea of how a RedXRX enforced memory layout looks like, let me move to the range checks. So for this, I'm going to use an example. This is a real function from the Linux kernel version 3.19. And as you can see, it contains three memory reads in the highlighted lines, line 1, line 2, line 4. If one was about to naively instrument this function, it would look like this. So for every memory read, we would need to spill and fill the RFLAX value, the RFLAX register, so that we retain the original execution flow. It would load the effective address to a reserved register, in this case R11, and then it would compare the end of data, it would compare this register with the end of data. If it's higher, we call a violation handler because it's an attempt to read code. If it's lower, it's a data read and we allow it. Notice, however, that for just three memory reads, we added 15 instructions. And as you can imagine, in terms of overhead, this is not good. And we actually measured it using LMBench, a benchmarking tool that, that measures the latency of system calls and the bandwidth of operations in the kernel. And as you can see, on average, it had approximately 2.24 times an overhead for the latency. And even in bandwidth, where we usually have very low overhead, we see that it has 32%. What this means is that in this version, the RedXRX component alone is not able to be used in any practical sense. So let me now show you some tricks that we came up with to reduce this instrumentation from 15 instructions to just one, providing the same security guarantees, and also dropping the overhead from two times to just 2%, less than 2% in latency. So let me start with the first one. For the first one, we wanted to eliminate as many push-f, pop-f pairs as we could because they're very, very expensive operations. And if you look at this function, you will see that for the first memory read and the third memory read, the RFLAX value is not necessary to be retained. Why? Because the compare instruction, the first one, and the OR instruction that immediately follows the move instruction on the third one, they both override the value of RFLAX. As a result, we could eliminate the push-f, pop-f pair in those range checks. On the other hand, in the second memory read, we see that the conditional jump that follows the move instruction does need the value of RFLAX. So we needed to find a way to differentiate between those two cases. Fortunately, this is a pretty standard problem. Compilers have been doing that for years. It's a standard compilation technique called liveness analysis, and by applying it on the RFLAX register, we were able to eliminate approximately 94% of all the push-f, pop-f pairs that we would emit in the naive instrumentation. This had a huge impact in the overhead. So from two times overhead, we dropped to 17%, and in bandwidth, we dropped to 3%. However, if you look at the numbers closely, you will see that, for instance, select has still an overhead of 60%, open-close has 40%, so it's still, in some cases, the overhead is very, very large. So we wanted to do more. The second optimization focuses on layer instructions. So if you look again at the function, you will see that all memory reads, they use the same addressing mode. They have a base register and an offset. This is an extremely common addressing mode for the kernel and in general in C, because this is how in assembly you access members of structs. As a result, what we did is that we modified this using an arithmetic trick. Essentially, we lower the end of data by the offset, and then we compare that to the base register. so that we eliminate the layer instructions. By applying this optimization, we were able to eliminate approximately 95% of all the layer instructions we would emit in the previous version. In terms of overhead, even though the average it goes higher, that's because of some outliers, for instance, in fork. If you look at the rest of the benchmarks, in most cases, this reduced the overhead. So we're doing better, but we're still far from being practical. So let's move to the third optimization. This is applicable in functions that look similar to this. In this case, if you look at the function, you will see that all three memory reads, they use RSI, and this register is neither spilled and filled in memory, nor is it modified throughout the execution of the function. This means that conceptually we can think of its value as a constant. And then what we can do is, what we do for every memory read is that we compare this constant, we add an offset to this constant, and we compare it with a number. However, if the maximum offset plus this constant is less than the end of data, this means that any other offset that's smaller than the maximum one is also going to be less than the end of data. As a result, using this observation, we can eliminate completely range checks. So in this case, in this function, the maximum offset is the first one. So what we can do is that we can eliminate the second and third memory read in range check. Notice here that if the maximum offset was not the one of the first one, but for instance the hex 140 of the second one, we would have to adjust the number that we subtract from the end of data in the range check so that we always use the maximum offset. By applying this methodology, we were able to eliminate approximately 50% of all the range checks we would emit. And this had a huge impact as well in the overhead. So we reduced the overhead from 17% to less than 11, and in bandwidth to less than 3. And if you look at most cases, excluding fork, which is pretty unpredictable in its behavior to code modifications, most of the tests here, they have a lower overhead. So let me do a small recap. We started with 15 instructions, and we now have 2. And this is as low as good as we can go for legacy hardware. However, for newer CPUs, we can do something better. So let me talk very briefly about Intel MPX, Memory Protection Extensions. It's a new instruction set architecture extension introduced in the Intel Skylake microarchitecture, and it introduces 4 new registers, bound 0 to bound 3. Those registers hold 2 values, the upper bound and the lower bound. The idea of MPX is to do hardware-assisted bound checking. Essentially, think of having a buffer. You set the lowest address that belongs to this buffer to be the lower bound of, for instance, bound 0, and you set the highest address that belongs to this buffer to be the upper bound. Then, before you dereference any member of this buffer, you use the bound CU instruction that checks if it falls below the upper bound, and the bound CL instruction that checks if it falls above the lowest bound, and as a result, you can prevent attacks such as buffer overflows. In KRXRX, we used it in a slightly different way. So what we did is that we set the upper bound to be the end of data, and then we instrumented every memory read with bound CU instructions. Those instructions, when they detect that the effective address of the memory read is higher than the upper bound, they automatically trigger an exception. Notice that we're still in the same function, so we can perform the third optimization I talked before, so we can eliminate the second and third memory read. And as a result, we end up with the one instruction instrumentation I promised you in the beginning. And to fulfill my second promise, this is the overhead of the MPX scheme. So as you can see, we have an overhead that's less than 1.5% in latency. Remember that we started with about 2 times. And an overhead that falls below 0.5 that's negligible in the bandwidth. So now that I've discussed the main cases, how we optimize the general cases, let me talk about some special instances of memory reads. So We didn't have to instrument approximately 4% of all the memory reads that we encountered, and that's because they were safe reads. Essentially, they were either RIP relative simples or absolute memory reads. And this means that an attacker doesn't have any way of influencing the effective address, and therefore there is no reason for us to instrument it. The second special case is string operations. So moves and loads, all these instructions, they use RSI implicitly as their source operand. So when we encounter them, we instrument them using RSI as the base register. However, in the case of rep prefix instructions, we do something different. So instead of doing something complex, such as taking the value of RSI and adding the value of RCX and figuring out the scale and things like that, we use the following observation. The compiler, when it emits rep prefixed instructions, it always has the direction flag cleared. This means that RSI always goes to a higher address. So what we can do is that we can place the range check after the operation, where RSI will point to the highest address that it read, and therefore do post-mortem detection without affecting any code optimizations and without doing complex computations. The last thing I'm going to talk about regarding the read XOR X component is stack reads. So in case when we have the full addressing mode, and that is we have an offset, then RSP, the stack pointer, is the base register, and then we have index and scale, we normally instrument them using range checks. And that's because an attacker could affect the value of the index and force the effective address to be in the code section. However, when we have the addressing mode of the stack pointer plus an offset, we don't instrument it. Instead, what we do is the following. We place a guard section between the end of data and the code lowest address that belongs to the code. And then we make this guard section that we name KRX Phantom to be higher than the maximum offset that we encounter in such memory reads. This way, if an attacker places it to the highest address that belongs to the data region, it will only be able to read the zeros from the guard section. Notice that this is possible because the stack pointer, because of its operation, needs to point to a writable page. So the attacker cannot place it higher. So now that I've shown you how the read XRX component looks like, both in terms of the memory layout and in terms of the range checks, let me move to the fine-grained KSLR component. I'm also going to use an example for this. So here we have three functions. Function one that has one code block, function two that has two code blocks, function three that has three code blocks. Code blocks, you can think of them as basic blocks or bigger slices of the function, depending on how granular you want to be. So the first thing we want to do is perform code block permutation so that the location of any gadgets within the function is not known to the attacker. It does not remain in the original location. Notice, however, that in function one, we only have one code block. So permuting that gives us an entropy of zero. And even in function two, we only have two code blocks, which means that the entropy is just one bit. So to solve this problem, we introduce a notion of phantom blocks. Phantom blocks are randomly sized code blocks that contain in three instructions, and those in three instructions, when executed, they raise exceptions. And we use those to pad the functions that don't have enough code blocks by themselves. By padding those, by adding those code blocks to the functions, we are now able to permute them. And since we want to maintain the original control flow, we have to add the unconditional direct jumps necessary so that the first instruction that's executed belongs to the first code block, and also the fault throughs are correct. By doing all these tricks, we have now created an unpredictable internal function layout. Essentially, even if an attacker manages to leak a code pointer, such as a return address, from within the function, he has no information about where the gadgets that belong to this function are located, because they belong to permuted code blocks. The next randomization we perform is pretty straightforward. It's function permutation. So now we permute at the function level, and by applying this, we are able to create an unpredictable surrounding area on the function. So even if an attacker manages to leak a function pointer from the heap, he has no information about which function is before or after that. Thus, leaking that code pointer doesn't give him any information about the rest of the code region. The next thing I'm going to talk about is return address protection. So, as I told before, using the previous techniques, we have prevented offline code reuse and direct just-in-time code reuse. Let me now show you how, with the return address protection, we prevent indirect just-in-time code reuse attacks. So in this case, the first scheme I'm going to present is based on encryption. So the idea here is very simple. We place a unique key for every routine in the non-readable region so that an attacker is not able to read it. And at the function entry, at every function entry, we take this key and we XOR encrypt the return address. This way, if an attacker scans the stack to looks for return addresses, it will only see encrypted versions of the return address. Notice that in order to avoid to prevent replay attacks, we replenish the keys at boot time if they belong to the kernel image, or at load time if they belong to a loadable module. So this is pretty straightforward. The second protection scheme, though, is a bit more complex. So here, the idea is that we want to hide the return address within other similar looking addresses. We call this return address decoys. So the idea is that we introduce a notion of the phantom instructions that I'm going to talk about in the next slide. And we give the address of these phantom instructions in the call site to the reserved register. And then using the code snippets I have in this slide, we place the return address either before or after the real one. This is, of course, something that we decide randomly at compile time. Using this technique, we now have two similar-looking return addresses. One of them is valid, the other one is not. So what's the phantom instructions? Phantom instructions are conceptually NOP instructions. So in this case, it's a move a value to the reserved register, which doesn't affect neither the flags nor any other part of the execution of the function. But within them, unaligned, they contain tripwire opcodes, essentially opcodes that cause exceptions when executed. So if the CPU looks at this instruction and starts executing from the 49 opcode, it sees a move instruction. However, if we point the CPU to the CC instruction, it sees an IN3 instruction, which in turn will trigger an exception. So what we do is that we insert in the routine's code stream the phantom instructions, the whole move instruction, and then we pass through the call site the address of the tripwire opcode to the reserved register, and therefore the callee places it either before or after the real one. So what this means is that if an attacker scans the stack, he will see two return addresses. One, and if he makes the mistake of picking the wrong one, it will cause an exception and allow us to detect it. The last thing I'm going to talk about are some limitations. So if you looked at those return address protection schemes that I described, they're both callee-based. Essentially, the callee is responsible for encrypting or hiding the real return address. This is a choice we made because it facilitates mixed code. So essentially, let's assume that somehow you formally verify the module and you want to load it. By using those protection schemes, you now don't have to instrument this module. However, this decision led to some limitations. The first one is based on the fact that from the time the return address is placed in the stack to the time that we encrypt it or hide it, there are two or three instructions, depending on the scheme, that have the return address as plain text in the stack. This creates, of course, a race condition. However, we believe and we posit that this is pretty difficult to take advantage of in a reliable way because of the nature of the kernel. And what do I mean by that? Let's assume that an attacker tries to do so. So what he will have to do is that he will try to use a different process, presumably, to read the stack of another one. To time so that he can leak return addresses, he will have to take care of the system call interface, which by itself is a few thousand instructions. And also, he has to deal with process scheduling that the attacker has no control over and could obviously mess with the timing, cache misses, DLB flashes, and so on. All of them, they create an environment that's pretty difficult for attackers to take advantage from. So we believe, and we actually tried it and we failed, that this type of attack is not easy to do, it's not easy to do in a reliable fashion. However, there is another type of attack that's much more possible. This is substitution attacks. So here, imagine that you have a function foo that has two call sites, bar and foo bar. So what the attacker can do is that he can allow bar to call foo and then replace the return address, the protected return address, with the call site of foo bar. Thus, he would start with bar and move to foo bar, whereas it shouldn't. Notice, however, that in order for this attack to work, the attacker would have to use a valid dynamically leaked return site, which may or may not be easy to do. And in any case, it can be prevented using register randomization, something that we plan to do for as part of our research work, for future work. So now that I'm done with the design of KRXRX, let me talk briefly about some macro benchmarks, some macro benchmark evaluation. For this, we use the Foronix test suite, a suite that provides us the ability to run real user space applications and benchmarks. And as you can see, we have two columns. The first one is the SFI scheme of the readXRX component alone, with no randomization and no return address protection. And the second one is the MPX version of the same. And as you can see, on average, we have an overhead of 2.15 for the SFI scheme, which we believe is low enough for practical use. And if you look at the numbers, you will see that all of them are less than 5%, whereas we have an outlier in Postmark. In general, Postmark is a bad case for us because it acts mostly as a micro benchmark. Essentially, it spends about 85% of its time in the kernel space, stressing our instrumentation. But however, even with the presence of Postmark, we have an average overhead of 2.15. In the case of MPX, the overhead is negligible, is less than 0.5%. So obviously, you can get some execute-only memory using MPX essentially for free. Now, if we were to provide complete protection, so couple the SFI scheme with the fine-grained KSLR component, the overhead would raise. In the worst case, it's about 4%, it's a little bit over than 4%. Again, if you look at the numbers, most of them are less than 10%. We have an outlier with Postmark that goes to 20. And in the case of coupling SFI with the encryption scheme, the overhead drops to approximately 3.63. Both of these numbers are below the 5% threshold, so we believe they are practical. Obviously, if you were to couple MPX with the fine-grained KSLR component, the overhead is much lower. So coupling MPX with the randomizations and the decoys gives us an overhead of approximately 2.32%, whereas MPX plus encryption gives us 2.62%. So in both those cases, you can get a real comprehensive kernel protection against just-in-time code reuse attacks, paying really low overhead. So to summarize, I presented KRXRX, a system that protects the kernel against just-in-time code reuse attacks. It's based on two main components. The first one is the readXRX component. The second one is the fine-grained KSLR one. It utilizes hardware assistance whenever this is possible through the use of Intel MPX. And it has a low overhead of 3.63% in the best case for the SFI version of the scheme, and 2.32 in the best case for MPX-based scheme. Notice that I have a link there. It's the code. We right now in the repo, we only have the patch. Over the summer, I'm going to refactor the code for the plugins and add it to them. And with this, I'm happy to take any questions you might have.